بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وإذا لقوا الذين آمنوا قالوا آمنا وإذا خلوا إلى شياطينهم قالوا إنا معكم إنما نحن مستهزئون. About some type of these منافقين most likely Jewish origin but not necessarily could be also Arab Ansari who are close and allies to the Jews. They publicly announce that they are believer but when they meet with their shayateen with their devils or satans we'll discuss about satan more in details. They said to them don't worry that what we say publicly is just to mock these guys, taking them for a ride. They are fools. They're easily fooled and easily taken for a ride. Just fooling them. So Allah, I just want to say Allah is mocking them. And how he mocks them, what's the meaning of Allah mocking them? Because they are starting with the mockery. They pretending to be something which they are not, to fool some other people. And Allah leave them in their tughyan, in their excessive and their transgression, wavering around like the blind or someone who has weak sight or blind, who goes right and left, who doesn't have a stick and doesn't know how to go and then go from wall to wall to touch his way. So that's the way Allah is mocking them. That's the way the mockery of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is expressed toward them. So this is proper reward for their act. Allah does not start mocking anybody to initiate as an initiating act because it's mocking someone is denigrating and Allah does not initiate denigration to anybody whatsoever. But if someone denigrates others or deserves denigration, then as a punishment, Allah will denigrate him and mocks him. And appropriately for these munafiqeen, the mocking of them is just leaving them in their misguidance, going right and left center without finding any way. Now, إِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَى شَيَاطِينِ The word shaytan has become Satan, which is translated to Satan, or devils, devil, has become widely spread and understood by most people in relation to a bit with Beelzebub, to Iblis, these type of conscious, quote and unquote, because we'll discuss if the jinns or the abalis are really conscious being or not in the proper sense, because there are many discussion about the nature of the angels and of shayateen, etc. What they are reality is that really conscious being, like human beings with self identity, self recognition, etc. Or it is a metaphor for some kind of evil entities in the universe which are not necessarily as conscious as the people may think. We discuss that with the angels when we come in due course. But let's divide whatever called shaitan in the usual expression. The Arab use the word shaitan for anyone who is rebellious and mischievous. And that's what was used by the Quran and Sunnah, but also adding to that, the Prophet used it also to point anything which is harmful. Noted according to the natural way, there's something unnatural or harmful. An example for this is when we check the famous story of the woman who was bleeding, continuously bleeding, and she asked her Prophet what to do with that, with this menses. Say, this is not your normal menses. This is a kick of the devil, the kick of Satan, rakla min shaytan. We know it has nothing to do with Iblis and so on. Meaning, this is some kind of a weakness of one of the veins or of the arteries, and it is broken, it breaks, and it leaks blood. So it is a bleeding, not a normal menstrual bleeding, which is necessary to dispatch of non-fertilized eggs, which have to be checked out, and the womb will be prepared for the next cycle, probably for consumption, if it may happen. But if conception does not happen, then the egg is obviously expelled, dies and expelled with some surrounding because it clings to the wall of the womb. If it's not fertilized, it doesn't develop in a fetus and it's expelled. That's a normal process, painful. Headache, yeah, maybe, but it is a normal process, part of the way human beings are created. But the other one, the bleeding is not normal. The continuous bleeding isn't normal. There may be some kind of fibrosis, maybe some kind of weakness of the blood arteries, of blood vessels and so on, which breaks and leaks blood. And the Prophet described that as a kick of the devil. It's a kick of the devil. It means it's an act of some kind of evil or harmful entity, What's it? Is it a bacteria? Is it a virus? Is it maybe just due to certain imbalance in the immune system? Whatever it is all an act of something evil. It has nothing to do with the devil, which is discussed as the entity which has objected to the creation of Adam and which will come down the road. So beware, don't be fooled by when you think that we said shayateen. And the Quran says clearly, shayateen al-insi wal-jinn. So there's from ins, there's shayateen, and from jinn, from the hidden creature, from the jinn means the things which are hidden. Something is the dark entities, the invisible entities, there are also shayateen. And from these also, the jinn themselves are various categories, which will come when we talk about jinn in more detail. So not always jinn is that what the people conceive as being conscious beings who seem to be quite similar to humans in matter of mental and capacity, similar, not necessarily exactly, and free will. So they can choose and they can embrace faith like and become believer or non-believer like in Surah al-Jinn. Can be fooled, can be misguided by the chief Iblis, etc. So that's important to keep that in mind. So not everywhere when you see in the Quran Sunnah shaitan, meaning that the hadith of Abu Hurairah that a man that he was ordered to guard the fitrani, the zakat al-fitr, and a man came and then he caught a man who was filling some bags and he caught him and he pretended, I'm a poor man, I have a family, I don't have nobody to feed, and Abu Hurairah became soft and let him go. Second day and the third day, the man taught him some eye for self-protection. And Rasam asked him, do you know with whom you were dealing all these three nights? It is a devil. It's a shaitan. Does not mean necessarily one of these invisible entities. It could be very a shaitan of human beings. It's a shaitan, a rebellious, non-obedient, harmful being. Someone who was get habituated to steal and lie and to get his way out by lying and pretending to be what he is not. So that's concerning shaitan. Here, it's most likely, it is their leaders of nifaq and because they have to go to them in seclusion. إِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَى شَيَاطِينِهِمْ, when they are in seclusion with their shayateen. And it's most likely, most of us see that this relates to the Jews, because the Jews were their leaders, the leader of confrontation to the Prophet ﷺ. For various things, and we'll discuss some of them will come in Surah Al-Baqarah, plenty actually, so we will postpone that to its right time. But they tell them, what we say publicly is not what they believe, we are with you, we share with you the same allegiance with him, don't believe in this prophet, or we are not going to be following his commandments and orders, even if we believe he is a prophet, because some Jews believe the prophet is a prophet. They don't deny his prophethood, but they don't want to follow him and be under his leadership and be with him in cooperation and allegiance. They were not alleged to him. So there's not enough to believe that he is a prophet. It could be very well, but many Jews believe that he's a prophet, but he's a prophet for the Arabs, not for us. We're not obliged to follow him. We don't want anything to do with him. Because obviously this was possible in their mind, a way of thinking, because their mindset that does not understand prophethood, the prophets of Allah, what they are and what's possible for them, what's not. They don't understand properly and they don't have the correct concept of Allah and his prophets. And from this wrong understanding of Allah and his prophets, they fell in that trap. They could be very well at testifying that Muhammad is a prophet, but they aren't willing to follow him, or even they're plotting and fighting against him. They find that is perfectly permissible, especially those who have some kind of Kabbalistic and pagan intermixed in their beliefs, which are, there are quite a number of factions and they have contradicting beliefs. So when you hear Jews, don't think about the Jews, for example, in Golders Green, who are really rabbinic Jews and so on. No, there are many sects, and the sects in Medina may have been more of the Kabbalistic mythical category, which have quite a number of misguided beliefs and contradicting really the essence of the Torah and the previous scripture, but they still were able to declare them Jews and so on. So Jews and Judaism is a very complex phenomena, and people have written about that volumes, especially from the Muslim camp and Arab camp. Dr. Abdul Wahab Masiri has an encyclopedia of Judaism. We show them that he compares them to a geological formation, layer on layer, various layers of beliefs and historic interaction and so on. So this is nothing really unified concerning Jews as the religion. As a race, that's another issue. Most significant Jews in the world now, they call them Jews, are not from Bani Israel, manifestly and definitely by genetic testing and also by their own admission. Like, for example, the Ashkenazi Jews are essentially mostly converts, although some of them intermixed with original Israeli Jews, mostly from Caucasian Jews. But due to a conversion of one king there in around the time of the after the advent of Islam for one or two centuries, one king there converted to Judaism and more enforced or invited his people to convert to Judaism. And the Ashkenazi Jews, one of the leadership really of the Judaism, because the Sephardim, the one who most predominantly from Israelite origin, not exclusive, but predominantly, these are not even from Bani Israel, and they know that, so that's well known. But they are Jews by belief, not by race or something. So that's a complex issue, and then we have all the modern issues of anti-Semitism and so on. All of this is really a cover-up for anti-Zionism and the Zionistic agenda to establish a certain temple or establish waiting for a certain Messiah and things like that. But that is will merge with more with issues of politics and world dominance rather than really genuinely what Judaism as a religion could be defined, especially those who are seems to be adhering to the Torah and committed to it. Like, for example, many of the Jews of the Naturai Karta in New York, they are extremely opposed to the state of Israel and Zionism because they believe this is a violation of the injunction of the Torah. And then most likely they are right, because after the Babylonic exile, they were ordered to submit to foreign kings as a punishment for them until the Messiah comes. The Messiah came and gone, and they have missed him. But this is another discussion. Maybe some of it will come in its time, inshallah. So, the one said these shayateen we refer to are these the leadership of the anti-Prophet Muhammad Jews leadership there. Some of them are Arabic origin, like for example, Ka'b ibn Ashraf, who led to whose assassination, whose confrontation with Muslims and Islam after the Battle of Badr. And his assassination led to the writing of the Covenant of Medina or the Karta of Medina. He himself is from the tribe of Tay. He is not pretend. His mother is Jew, but his father, so genealogically, normal genealogy in the Arab is going through along the fatherly line. But he chose to live with the Jews and become one of the leader personality. And they adopted him because for them also it's more important to be having a Jewish mother than a Jewish father. But he's from the tribe of Tay, which is a Yemeni tribe, well-known and is still available in Arabia, and the genealogy is known, and I have some geological studies about them in my folders and so on. Nevertheless, he was one of the leaders and was of the shayateen, the one who was instigating Quraysh against the Prophet. So this is the shayateen, the one who instigating against the Prophet and who take the leadership. And they are the one who were meeting secretly with those munafiqeen and so on and plotting with them against the Prophet continuously until they were expelled from Medina and finished from it. And they're plotting all backfired against them one by one. So that's about the word shayateen, and we'll have more to say about her. So they publicly claim if they believe like inshallah on Muhammad Rasulullah, but then they made the shayateen. Don't worry, that's just to fool these simpleton, these fools, these simple-minded, gullible guys. Take them for a ride, and Allah mocks them. And the way He mocks them is just leave them in their misguidance, because if Allah would for example, meet some kind of punishment or strike them with a physical harm or something like that, because of that, this may awaken them to their that it's maybe a divine punishment, and they will start reviewing their situation and maybe they become believer. Instead, He let them down and leave them in their misguidance, so there's no external motivation or external factor which will get them back to review their situation and recognize their error. That's the way Allah is mocking it. I mock you this same way you are mocking the believer. I will mock you. Just leave you in the misguidance. So that these people are not. And also Allah mentioned about the munafiqeen, but this is later. I mean, later they say some of them, so munafiqeen of Ansar of the Arabs or of the Jews, all right, when they come to Rasulullah, they greet him not the way Allah has ordered him to be greeted. Allah said he should be greeted with respect. Assalamu alayka ya Nabi. Assalamu alayka, assamu alayka, assam, poison or death on you. And the Rasulullah, either he doesn't hear it, or if he hears, he pretends he did not hear it, and they say, alaykum. I think the many famous narration about that. And one time, Aisha recognized what they said, and she exploded in anger, say, alaykum wa la'natullahi wa ghadabih. When they left her, Rasulullah said, Aisha, cool down, relax. Allah hates violence and such excesses. She said, you did not hear what they said. Say, assalamu alaykum. Say, I hear. And they said, wa alaykum, on you also too. That's it. No need for more response than that. What's the reason to say, wa alaykum wa la'natullahi wa ghadabih, Allah cares on you, and so on, directly. Leave them. But they say it in such a voice that it may be confused, like a salam. Say shalom, shaum, or sham, or something like that. It could be good. So most people will hear it as salam. But say, wa alaykum. I didn't say, that's it. So that's the way of to behave with such kind of people. And that, but what they were saying in their hearts, say, if he is a prophet really, why Allah is not punishing us for that what we are saying? That's it. They regard that as an evidence that Allah is not aware about that what they are doing, or he's aware and he's not protecting this. This must be a false prophet. He's not protecting him. They think when Allah sent a prophet, he must protect him from being insulted. He must protect him from, it's not necessary. Many prophets have been even killed. Allah did not protect them from being killed. Actually being killed, becoming for them, lifting them a higher rank of martyrdom, prophethood plus martyrdom. So, but they don't understand how the universe is structured, understand how the faith and the written decision of Allah, which has been made at the beginning of the universe, is that coming to faith has to be on a free act and rational consideration and pondering about the revelation, not by Allah coming outside normally, but sometimes it happens really. And even if it happens, like in the case of Musa, it was happening continuously, the various miracles, it did not help the people, did not benefit them. So fundamentally, it's only the way is to ponder about this prophet, his evidences, what he says, how fits that with the reality of the universe, with the proper meaning of Allah as the creator of the universe, and establish of all what's happening, allowing whatever to happen there. That's the way to go. Not to think, I should provoke Allah and see if he punish me back, then I know he's really there and he's punishing me. That's the way of the which lead downhill, the way of decline. And that shows no attempt to understand how the universe really functions, how it works. So they were saying, why Allah is not punishing us for that what we're saying? Meaning is either he's not aware, he doesn't know what's going on. Shows definitely a major misunderstanding of Allah's comprehensive knowledge, or he doesn't care to protect his prophet. That's not true. He's actually responding by letting them go astray, and they will be, and the Quran answers the case of those who say, why Allah will not punish you? As for that, what we are saying, when we greet a prophet with the wrong greeting and the bad words twisted so that it sounds good, but it's actually bad, Allah says, "Hasbuhum jahannam yaslawnaha wa bi'sa al-masir." It's for enough than the hellfire. Hellfire is waiting. That's enough for them. That's the punishment. Enough for them. So this is in the manhan. We say Allah yastahzi'u. So that's the way Allah mocks these those who mocking His messenger and the believer, not by sending them stones from heaven or filling the houses with fires or punishing the dunya. Because that's opposite. Maybe they may have a very nice life, income, beautiful horses, beautiful cars, very nice livelihood, which will fool them further and leave them. Leave them in their misguidance, wavering right and left and center. So, and then Allah continues to say, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَوُوا الضَّلَالَةَ بِالْهُدَىٰ فَمَا رَبِحَتْ تِجَارَتْهُمْ وَكَانُوا مُهْتَدِينَ. I think we reached that last time. Right? So they exchanged ضلالة, they call and use the word شَرَب, but they bought misguidance and for the price of guidance. So they have guidance in their hand, the guidance there. Guidance, they have the guidance, definitely. They have the revelation, and they have the mental capacity, and they have the free will to do it. That's all under their control, in their hand. And it shows, instead of using that valuable, keeping that valuable asset, they extend it for misguidance. We don't want to leave it. We prefer to be misguided. We prefer to go astray. We prefer not to use our rational faculty. We prefer not to use our free will to overcome our weaknesses, our our prejudices, our commitment to our fear of the society, because many people do not embrace faith because they feel if we do, then we'll become odd in a society which is hostile to this point of view. And this is too much of a price to pay, the price for guidance. So he prefers to exchange, accept misguidance and give up the guidance. So that is the metaphor used in the Quran of the before of buying and selling. It's very often used, almost everywhere in the Quran we see that they bought misguidance with paying the price as paying by not by gold and silver, but by paying off for the highest and good you could ever possibly have, which is your right of equality and your freedom, which is guidance. That's the guidance which you have intrinsically built in yourself. Rational faculty and free will. But it has to be used, it has to be activated, it has to be made effective. Instead of that, no, we give that up and we accept the misguidance instead. So as if we are doing a business deal, which is obviously a catastrophically a deal, which is certainly is not going to be a winning deal. It's really a losing it. فَمَا رَبِحَ تِجَارَةُ مَكَانُ They are neither their exchange or their deal is not a winning deal. It's actually a massively losing deal. And they are definitely because they have given up the guidance, they are not guided. They are not muhtadin. They are not people of Hidayah because the essential elements of Hidayah has been forsaken and exchanged for easy living, not confronting the society, not confronting with the regimes, not confronting with this, not confronting with that. Sometimes just out of laziness, I'm not going to change. I'm not going to give up what I inherited from our parents and our grandparents, our culture. I'm not going to give our culture for something new. I just keep our culture, forget about that, leave it. Without, although rational consideration and free will should have resulted in something else. Now we come then, Allah give example for these, two examples actually. Ibn Qayyim discussed this example from another point of view, which I don't think is very productive. It is the first example is the ayah number 17. مثلهم their example is كمثل الذي استوقد نارا فلما أضاءت ما حوله ذهب الله بنورهم وتركهم في ظلمات لا يبصرون. Let's go to Islam Awakened. This is ayah number 17. Yes, the literal translation say their example in parentheses is, because I said literal translation you have sometimes insert certain verbs which are not in the Arabic original, so it's almost literal. Their example like, but in English you cannot say like, say is like. The, in parentheses, the example of, also of in parentheses, you have in front of you, I think if you have a laptop or something like that, the one who kindled a fire. Then when it illuminated what was around him, took away Allah their light. This is obviously in the order of Arabic, the English would be Allah took away the light, but that's okay. In English, sometimes in Shakespeare English, you can rearrange the sentence this way. Allah took away their light and left them in darkness or darknesses, because the Quran used the plural. So, not do they see, so they don't see anything. So what is the meaning of that? Let us analyze it a little bit. So the example is like someone who kindled the fire. He ignited the fire until everything around him was illuminated and visible and clear. Then a word comes, which is a little bit sometimes people misunderstand. We discussed the action of Allah, what they mean. Allah took away their light. But we know Allah does not take away anybody's light. So what does it mean? Allah has allowed the light to be taken away. But how is the light was taken away? Light, remember here we attack light. We're talking about light, not the fire. The fire is still burning. The fire is still on. So how the light can be taken away? We're not talking about a miracle, obviously. Make the expression. Meaning Allah allowed them to lose the light by closing. They chose to close their eyes. That's it. They explode the fire, and this could not happen in the universe except by Allah's permission. In the original meaning of creation, that the universe allows free agents like human beings who are not the divine, the only one divine free agent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is unfallible. It's impossible for Allah to do that, to happen something like that to him. But other free agents who are not perfect, who have to struggle to go to higher levels of perfection, they can very well exercise their free will against their better judgment. So after everything is around them, they saw the light, everything is clear, they decide, no, we don't want it. They close their eyes. And this closing of the eye did not happen against Allah's will. Could not happen. It would not be possible to happen without Allah's permission, but it happened with Allah's permission. That's the meaning, Allah took away their light. Allah allowed their light to be taken away, and the only way it can be taken away, the light is meaning really the light of the eye, the insight. This is a fair metaphor for the insight. They close their eyes. Obviously, what we mean is the mental eyes. They chose to ignore their insight and just check it out. And they then were in complete darkness. See the eye? Okay. So he left them, or they ended in being in darknesses where they are unable to see. Again, what it's seeing here is meaning the insight, the mental seeing. And the Quran continues saying the next ayah, صُمٌ بُكْمٌ عُمْيٌ فَهُمْ لَا. They are deaf, blind, and mute. They will not come back from this situation. Once you have seen the light completely, and then you make that decision, it is unlikely. The normal course of things is that there's no way out of that. You are blind by choice, by closing your eyes. The same apply also that you don't hear anything, because it's here the metaphor of seeing, because the seeing is the most, let's say, the sense which is most connected us with the world and with the reality, but also hearing connects us. We hear what the people are saying and so on, and then we make a mental image of what they are saying as well. So also hearing is like a subcategory which leads us what can be seen with the eyes of the mind. So they are not hearing. And then based on that, they cannot utter or say anything which makes any sense. They are bukum, they are mute. Oh, does not mean that they cannot blabber in their language. Yes, but it is worthless and empty. It's as good as they are mute. So they are summun bukmun umn, fuhum la yarji'un. In that state, there's no way they can go back to the light. So this is one example of the type of the munafiqeen who have seen the light and they make a decision, no, we reject it. Or sometimes even public disbeliever, not only that, there's some people of that, like I said, like Fir'aun and co, we are going to reject that. We're not going to give up on our kingdom and power and get the greatest power on earth following two slaves and the slave nation is out of question. That's not acceptable. They have rejected that. And they then became obviously blind, mute, and deaf. They know they can't come back. That's one type. And the munafiqeen, there's one type of that. Publicly, they may say, we are believer, and try to think they're fooling the believer, they're getting away with that, but they have rejected that light. And they're finished, they're blind, deaf. Another type, so Ibn Qayyim calls that an example, a fire example, because the fire, and he says, the fire still continues, but the light is gone, so they have the heat of the fire and the pain of the fire without seeing the light, etc. Maybe, and I think he went too much in the metaphor of light and fire and water. I think it's what's important here, what's the stress is the light, which has, but that light has been someone, and also the important to say that he is the one who ignited the fire, and then everything. So he pondered and thought and analyzed, and then everything was clear to him. But then suddenly he decided, no, I'm not going to accept it. For what reason? By an act of free will. Closed his eyes, finished, gone, and refused. Whatever motivation, decided against his better judgment because he's the one stuck on the line. I think this is the stress also on closing the eye and losing the light. That's the stress. Not if that's the fire continued burning and they are blind, not seeing they have the heat of the fire. Not necessarily because you may be having a good distance from the fire and you have not just the warmth of the fire. Warming you in a cold night. So I don't think Ibn Qayyim discussed on this, putting too much weight on the fire does not do justice to the example. The example is like that. The stress is on the light and enlightenment and the insight. And the light theme is the light and the eyes and the blindness, all of this in mental and spiritual sense, not in physical sense. as if you do a physical sense. Right? But the example is giving a physical in physical terms. Another type of munafiqeen, كصيب من السماء, like a rainstorm or a thunderstorm, which has darkness. So it is it's very thick clouds, possibly even in the night. And it's a thunderstorm, so there are thunder, then there are lightnings. Lightning go on. They are in a state of fear and will. When the thunder comes, they put their fingers in their ears so that they don't hear the massive, terrifying sound of the thunder and of the striking of lightning and the thunderbolts, fearing to die from these. That's most likely the metaphor for what the revelation contains of warnings and threats and so on. So they're afraid of that. They think this has real merit and is really threatening. When it lightens, it almost blinds their eyesight. So they see the light. They see a glimpse of light. It overwhelms all their capability of insight and understanding. Yes, indeed, it does. So, but still, they can walk. They can find some of the way during this lightning. So you can see when the lightning bolt is there, or even just a lightning or a bolt has struck the earth nearby to you or far away from you. You see a little bit around you, then you can walk like few meters based on that light you have seen, and you locate. You can still walk a little bit, and then when there's no lightning, then and you have exhausted the distance you memorize from the previous lightning strike, they stop and they wait for another lightning to continue, maybe towards the cave or towards a protective place. So this situation, it gives you a mental image of people who have been surprised by at night, possibly by such a thunderstorm, and they are trying to get from that place, an open place where they may be a thunderbolt may hit them and kill them. They're afraid of death. They want to go to a safe place, maybe in a cave or some place where they have some protection from at least from the thunderbolts. And this is a state of confusion. You see a little bit and then you stop. You go a little bit and you are not certain what you are, where are you and where are you going. You have no certainty. You don't see the way. This is the type of munafiqeen who are wavering. They are sometimes they behave and they even think and like be a believer, and then they waver and go back to their disbelief because whatever motivation, whatever reason. So they are wavering. They are not firm in disbelief, like those who have closed their eyes and complete the darkness. And Allah says that in this situation, if Allah wished, they would have taken this hearing and their eyesight completely, but He did not. He let them in because Allah is capable of all things. So, meaning, in this kind of people, they have still an opportunity maybe to go back. There may be a possibility, and Allah decided not to blind them completely and take away their hearing and their faculties. So there might be still possibility. So this is the type of this of munafiqeen who are wavering. One day, the morning he's a believer, the afternoon he's doubting, the evening he's a believer, next day he's doubting, he's wavering. He's not firm, depending upon what the external condition was going on. So this is the not all the munafiqeen are just firm, staunch disbeliever internally, continuously hostile to Islam and Muslim, continually plotting against Islam, and not exposing themselves unless they feel safe enough to expose and they can get away without any calamity. There are others who really are wavering. They are not firm in that one, in the nifaq, and they are not firm in belief. They walk a little bit, they see a little bit, then they are blinded, etc. And that's because they unable or they are unwilling to firm themselves in faith. That happens most likely because they are not willing to do the homework. That's by pondering about the universe, pondering about revelation. Like Quran says, "If I let the Quran, then they ponder the Quran. Otherwise, if it's not from Allah, it would have been many contradictions." But this is not an easy job. You have to do the work. They don't want. and they prefer the easy way. For example, and the example which comes in my mind most of the time for this example of Munafiqeen is Marwan ibn al-Hakam. This man is sometimes, for example, he's a Quran memorizer, but his father has been hostile to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi and mocking him and was expelled to Taif. So he cannot overcome being loyal to his father against the Prophet. So sometimes he behaves like a believer, sometimes he acts like a non-believer, sometimes he give preference to his tribal association and so on, and try to get benefit from that, like when he became secretary of Uthman and plotted against him. Sometimes he's not doing that. When Abdullah ibn Zubayr called people to give him bay'ah after the death of Yazid, he almost gave bay'ah until someone instigating him not to give bay'ah and call for khilafah for himself. So he's wavering. He's not firm in anything because he's not willing to do his homework. So this is the wavering type of Munafiqeen. Let's read maybe the go back to letter translation so that translation is clear. The meaning is more important here. You can see the various translation. Let us go to the next ayah. See what is the literal translation, if there's anything to comment about it. I think there's nothing very much to comment. It's the meaning is the one which is really need to be ascertained. Literally, and also the important issue that what the action of Allah in the Rizu, how they are they a direct action, miraculous action, or they are just permission for action for which the action is really done by other entities. So the next ayah, number 18, deaf, dumb, blind, so they will not return. So they will not return. That's the literal. The non-literal ones were deaf, dumb, blind, and they cannot return back. That's, for example, Asad or Piktal, deaf, dumb, blind, and they are not, using the more classical English, Shakespearean English. So that's this one. Let's go to the next one. Number 19, see if there's anything to be, at least in the wording. Ayah number 19. Or like a rainstorm from the sky, and there are darknesses and the thunder and lightning. They put their fingers in. Let me leave the literal one. It's a bit clumsy. Let's go to Piktal. Or like a rainstorm from the sky, where is darkness, thunder, and the flash of lights, of lightning. They thrust their fingers in their ears by reason of the thunder, afraid of the thunder, claps, for fear of death. I think the Arabs tend to believe that the thunder is, if it is too loud, it can cause death. I'm not aware about anyone being killed by thunder, but most likely because usually it is connected with the lightning bolts and then it could be deadly. Maybe that's in their association of mind, but usually they are afraid of thunder and they regard it like a sound of an entity or sound of an angel, which may be bringing death and destruction. And that Allah is encompasses the disbelievers. Allah is in control of disbelievers. So that's so. And then in Biktal put in, try to give the meaning of that, also in his guidance, in his omniscience and his omnipotence. So Allah is in control of the disbelievers by guidance, by trying to make sense of the Allahumma hidhubika, Allah surrounding the disbeliever. They are under his control. So whatever they do, whatever they accept the guidance or not accept the guidance, nothing will happen without his permission. And even those who are wavering, Allah has in complete control of them, but because the system of the verse is so that he let them do the choice and let them do the matter, he has permitted them to do that. Not that is this happening against his will, it has with his permission. So that is he's encompassing everything in power, omnipotence, in knowledge, and also he gave the sufficient guidance, which if pondered properly and accepted, will lead to guidance and seeing the light properly. So this ayah number 19. That's this. The lighting almost snatches away their sight from the. So they, this is metaphor for that. The guidance which comes so strong, and the evidence is so, that's almost blinding them. It is so strong for them. They think they should close their eyes instead of opening the eyes and analyze more. Instead, they close their eyes. They think that it is so overwhelming. That's the reason they are wavering. So they sometimes overwhelmed, but instead of opening the eyes and full analyze the situation properly, they prefer to close the eye for a few seconds sometimes. Sometimes when you turn away from the lightning source and go towards maybe the cave where they want to find refuge, walk a little bit. So imagine a situation like that, people on the travel and suddenly surprised by such a thunder, the horrifying thunderstorm, and they try to find their escape. And that's the situation of these wavering one who came, who the revelation came with the rain, with the goodness of the rain, but associated with warnings and threats and the hard injunctions, like objection to fight, injunction to endure hardship, etc. And they not capable or not willing to deal with that the way it should be dealt with. Stand there and benefit from it, and benefit from the rain, and do whatever probably should be done. Instead, they are wavering, going left and center, trying to escape, trying to find protection for that what should not be regarded as an evil is rather good. But they did not comprehend the revelation as really the rain which brings life essentially, and these other things which you intermixed with it are necessary for the whole structure of the universe, necessary to enforce compliance, like the threats in the Quran, necessary to protect faith, like the injunction for jihad, even if it's painful, all of that, they are not willing. They are not capable to understand that this is this. You are not going to get rain without having thunderstorms and lightning. It is not possible. That's how the universe physically works. The same also how the revelation works. You're not going to get a revelation which will see so easy and so nice that there's no hardship on it. Even the easiest one, which we will come soon to discuss, the one to Adam, it did contain some hardship, a prohibition from a certain tree, which he failed even to comply with, although it should have been easy to comply. There must be some hardship. And otherwise, how can you progress in the level which make you capable of and worthy of becoming companionship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in paradise? That's not possible. There must be some kind of hardship to get you from the low level to the higher levels. So that's it. That's this ayat, lightning almost snatches away their sight from them. As often as it flashes forth for them, they walk therein. And when it darkens against them, there they stand still. If Allah willed, He could have destroyed their hearing and their sight, but He did not. Allah is able to do all things. So if Allah wanted, He would have done them the same thing He did with the previous people who closed their eye firmly, but He did not, because that's the way the universe has been structured, the way Qadar works. Now the next ayah is another topic completely. Now, it's actually a new paragraph, it's a new section. Now, after discussing the guidance for the believers, being that they are one type or two types, those who have been, as we discussed, have been pagan, and those who have been people of the book, or all believers, depending upon the different interpretations of the scholars in time past, and also the kafirin, the genuine kafir, and munafiqeen, with several ayahs about their types and their examples. Now, a general address to mankind. يا أيها الناس اعبدوا ربكم الذي خلقكم والذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. Oh human being, oh mankind, worship your Lord who created you and created those before you, so that you may ward evil. تتقون. We mean شر والتقوى means here in لعلكم تتقون. Most likely here likely you can protect yourself from the divine punishment, because failing to worship Allah who created you and the people before you will end in that you cannot protect yourself from the divine punishment. Here, this is tattaqun, here is really with the, essentially, the linguistic the essential linguistic meaning of taqwa is self-protection, so that you can protect yourself from punishment. Let's read first, and then we go to various important points here. Omen, obviously, Shakir or Yusuf Ali or Victor, O mankind, that's better. Worship your Lord, who had created you and those before you, so that you may ward off, in paradise, evil. You are evil. Actually, you may ward off the punishment, actually, here. Because if you don't worship Allah, you are liable of the punishment. And you will obviously will fall in the non-worship is itself evil by itself, because it means that you have failed to recognize the most fundamental aspect of the universe or the most fundamental injunction. Let us go this way. So it's addressed to all mankind. He's not addressing the believer only, addressing everyone. Believer, non-believer, kafir, munafiq, muslim, everyone. اعبدوا ربكم what's the meaning of ربكم that's really where we have to refer to the book of Tawheed in more details. The general understanding since almost the second or third Islamic century is that اعبدوا ربكم يعني perform salah, perform Ramadan, perform Hajj and so on. That's wrong. That's not اعبدوا ربكم. That's not what ibadah Allah has ordered the people to do. That's not what Allah is ordering to do. So what's the meaning of اعبدوا ربكم? Or what is the meaning of the ayah in the surah say ما خلقت الجن والإنس, I did not create man and jinn, humans and jinns except to worship me. That needs a deeper analysis to overcome the mistakes who started like in the second century when people declared, for example, certain acts as ibadat and other acts as mu'amalat, as interactions. And so the fiqh has been divided in fiqh of ibadat, worships, acts of worship, and all rites and rituals, and the fiqh of mu'amalat, interactions, buying, selling, etc., contracts. There are two large categories, which is not the best and nicest, the division of the fiqh anyway. And then it has been entrenched from early times, compounding the errors, which was also widespread in Arab minds, especially those who have been Christian and Jews. Let me give the example of the misconception. When Adi ibn Hatim, Ta'i, the famous nobleman of Arabia, Hatim, his son Adi, who was Christian from a certain sect, his sister was taken prisoner of war, and then she addressed the Prophet and the daughter of Hatim al-Tayy and so on. The Prophet treated her well. Her father was a man of good manners and good morality, and Allah loves these moralities. And then she wrote to her brother, listen, come and see this man, because he ran away to the Romans, because he's Christian and the Romans. And Hatim al-Tayy, they live in the area which is called now Hail, which is the tribe. Tayy is all now under the general name of a sub-tribe, but the name has become the bigger name for the tribe is called Shammar now. Shammar is essentially Tay. Anyway, whatever it is. And they were close to the Romans, and they were having good, long interaction with the Romans. Even when the Romans were pagan, they were having even, because these Tay, people of Tay were very, very ferocious fighter and very big highway robbers. They were very feared in Jordan, in Syria, and in the Levant generally. And the Romans were negotiating with them and sometimes recruiting some of them in a special brigades. They have brigades. They call them Thamud, because they live in the area of Thamud. So that the name Thamud survived long time. But anyway, we are not going to discuss all these issues of all tribes and genealogy. But Tay, they used to. There was a good recruitment from them in the Roman army even before they converted to Christians and continued in Christian times. There was always several regiments or brigades of Tay from Shammar or Tay origin. So he, being a Christian, escaped, ran away from the armies of Rasulullah towards the Roman, the Byzantine Empire at that time. So his sister wrote to him, encouraging him to review his situation. He said, listen, this man, come see this man. He is a noble man. If he is a king, then he is a better king than the Roman king. That is better you work with this king. You should be rational. You should be practical, pragmatic, or opportunistic, call it whatever you want. And if he's a prophet, then you join the prophet. Then you see if he is really the messenger of Allah and join him. Then you gain akhirah. Otherwise, you gain at least dunya. And the Romans, you are not gaining very much. And clearly, this man is successful and victorious. You'll be with the victorious. You'll not be stupid. So he accepted that and came. See, and here narrated himself, said, when I entered, accidentally, not accidentally, by Allah's design, permission, the Prophet was reading the ayah in Surah Al-Tawbah, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله والمسيح ابن مريم. They appointed their scholars and their monks, اتخذوا أحبارهم, their scholars, and their monks, رهبانهم, راهب, راهب is a monk, they appointed their scholars and their monks, lords beside Allah. أربابا من دون الله. والمسيح ابن مريم, and the Messiah, the son of Mary. They appointed him a lord beside Allah. وما أمروا إلا يعبدوا إلها واحدا لا إله إلا هو سبحانه وتعالى. They have been ordered to worship only one deity, one God, one deity. He is exalted and above that they share. So, Hadith, this is a great opportunity now to show that this man does not know what he is saying. He is blubbering any nonsense. He said, ما عبدناهم, we did not worship them. Not Isa. He cannot deny that they worship Isa. Because Isa is a Christian. From the one of the Trinitarian schools, which were predominant at the time, and for them, Isa, according to the Nicene Creed, is the divine, is a light from light, God from God, begotten, not made, before the invention of time in eternity. So that's a divine entity. But he is objecting to the monks and the scribes. Say, ما عبدناهم, we did not worship them. ما عبدناهم. Understood the misconception in his mind, and many Arabs also, which became more and more dominant and reached its ultimate peak in the Wahhabi movement lately. So he asked him this question: didn't they permit the prohibited and prohibit the permitted? Mean legislate, make halal haram and haram halal as a legislation, and you accept that? He said, yes, that's true, because the church council, they come and they decide something which was maybe in time past permitted, they declare to be prohibited. For example, these church councils at the time, they have declared that you cannot become a monk and devoted to Christ and seclude yourself for worship unless you are celibacy. Although they know from the scripture they have in their hand that all the disciples of Christ, all the early generations, they were married, they were married, even multi, they were having multi wives. To the tune that Paul, in one of the epistles attributed to Paul, it's not certain that's Paul, he says, let be the bishop or the leader of the community, the elder of the community, let him be married only to one woman. So he wanted them to be just one woman, not multiple. So they were even multiple women. They have polygamous. And now the church went to the extreme of prohibiting the marriage for the monks and for the elders of the community and the priests. That's an injunction of one of the conferences of the church later on. So the monks and the scribes met together and decided to make celibacy obligatory for the priests, for example, which was undermined later by Luther. But until that time, we didn't have Luther yet. So they gave themselves the right to legislate and obviously, Abdi ibn Hatim did not have any other way to say, yes, that's true. Say, فَتِلْكَ عِبَادَتُمْ, that's their worship. So worship meaning attributing to someone a divine attribute, a divine prerogative. In this case, sovereignty and the right of legislation and right of declaring something to be moral or immoral, good or bad. Because this is the meaning of sovereignty. Ultimately, it is the sovereign, the divine sovereign who made the injunction. This is good, this is bad, this is right, this is wrong, this is haram, this is halal. It is the divine sovereign. Nobody else. And if someone is giving this right, like, for example, the British Parliament, they believe that they have the right to legislation, prohibition, and the same with other parliaments. These are lords beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And attributing this to them, accepting that as valid and acceptable, is their worship. They are being worshipped. That's the worship. That's what the meaning, ما خلقت الجن وإنس ليعبدون. I didn't create humans and jinn except to worship me, meaning to acknowledge me as the Lord and the Sovereign. This is based on accepting that the creator, etc. That's based on that. But this is the essential meaning of worship. Accepting him as the legislator, the one who defines morality, the one who makes injunction. That's the worship. Also enforced by the Mithaq al-Fitrah, the covenant of nature of humans in its original creation. When Allah says, your Lord took the children of Adam from the backs of their fathers. That's symbolically the seed. So they are the seed. They call it Alam al-Dar, when they are still seed. وَأَشْهَدَهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. And ask them, أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ? Am I not your Lord? It's not your creator. This is not a matter of discussion. I am not your Lord. They said, yes, indeed you are. So we don't say, on Qiyamah, we have not been giving this covenant. Now, this covenant obviously is not enough hujjah on Qiyamah. The punishment will be only if a messenger comes. But this means in the nature of the man, in his own creation, in the creation of the mind, or the structure of the mind, the acknowledgement that the Lord, the creator of the universe, Allah is the Lord. And there's no other Lord. He's the sovereign. He's the real sovereign, nobody else. So, that's enforced. Also enforcing the question in the grave, according to Allah, when someone is buried, he will be asked three questions only. Man Rabbuk, who is your Lord? Not who is your creator. This is usually not a matter of dispute. Man Rabbuk, who is your sovereign Lord? Say Allah, the creator, the one who created the universe, don't create me. And who is your messenger? And who is what's your deen? What's your religion? That's, but who is your Lord? Rabbi Allah. And not ask about other attributes, especially this one. That's the meaning of worship. So the meaning of worship, so Abdul Rabbakum, not perform salah, perform zakah. This is all nonsense. These are rituals. They can be in a sharia, and another sharia cannot be. For example, and a sharia could contain, for example, a pray in a form which contains sujood and ruku'. Another sharia may contain just standing in front of the wall and hitting the wall with your head. If it's really the original sharia of how the wearing wall. Assuming it's a real sharia from Allah. But it is perfectly fine. That is a perfect form of worship. Another one, just make an injunction that you face east and just utter certain supplication. That's their ibadah, that's their salah. That's their namaz, their ritual of salah. But it's not ibadah. Ibadah is acknowledging that the one who gave this injunction is the Lord. And the only Lord is Allah. So we say, I'abudu rabbakum, worship your Lord. It means acknowledge the Lordship and sovereignty of your, the one who is really your Lord. And this Lord is not an unknown entity. No, it is the one who created you and created the ones before you. And the one who created you, this is the one who created the universe. And by other evidences, rational evidences, the creator of the universe could be. That it is impossible to have two creators, two divine entities who can create. And this is all discussed in the book. That's the whole business of the book of Tawheed, which is now the first part is translated, the second will be. So the whole business is to establish this point. So it's not that they stand still in front of the wall, not bowing, not kissing the... this is all not worship. Has nothing to do with worship. Worship is acknowledging the sovereign. And that's the reason, La ilaha, you say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, La ilaha illallah is it. And when you say it with the proper meaning in your mind, then you have complied with the command, I'abudu rabbakum, worship your Lord, acknowledge your Lord, acknowledge that he is the sovereign. So that you may tattaqoon, that you may become muttaqi, meaning he, that mean really original, so that you may ward evil, the evil of being. Maybe the word evil is better in Pictan, in the sense you word evil, you protect yourself from evil. Which evil is it? Evil in dunya is obviously the being without a correct sovereign. Then you, because you have to have, so you have to refer for action, for your actions in classifying them as halal, haram, or moral, or immoral. Even if we skip the, or prohibited or non-prohibited, there must be some authority you refer to. Either you refer it to yourself and your desires, and this is a catastrophe, because your desires and it does not necessarily represent the proper, which will make you so synchronized properly with the universe, so you will become an evil person. Your desires, so if your desire is that you see this neighbor is disturbing and you just jump and kill him, you are referring to your desire. And that's definitely an evil act and will bring you in confrontation with the society, which will apprehend you and kill you for that. or punish you or put you in jail for life or something like that. So it is evil, it is harmful for you. Or you refer to society and inherited norms and so on, and the misconception and so on. And this is also just a bunch of human beings who have certain, and it's clearly not a reference frame which can be trusted. Just look at it. It is very well acceptable if you are Korean to slaughter dogs and eat them. It will be shocking here in England. So people different, their taste, their tradition. In our own society, they don't mind eating horses. Here in England, for example, it is a calamity. It's a shock. So, meaning this it depends upon circumstances and conditions and historic development, which we cannot trust their variability and their meaning. If they make any meaning about the universe, or all of them are right and wrong. There is no right and wrong, and there is nothing moral or immoral. So that's the evil which in dunya, at least, which you, if you don't have the, if you don't worship Allah, if you don't accept that He's the sovereign and ultimate Lord. As a matter of brief and fundamental, you may think this is Allah's injunction and you are mistaken, but still, as a matter of creed, you are a worshiper. Even if you thought that this injunction is a divine injunction, it is not a divine injunction by mistake or by historic wrong analysis or by referring, for example, to a wrong hadith or misunderstanding of ayah. That misunderstanding is human. That's not a problem. That's not the issue. The issue is that fundamentally you refer. I usually give the following examples. For example, the most laws, the French law, for example, that the small children under 10 at least are not criminally responsible. If they commit a crime or something like that, then their responsibility is limited or non-responsible, and is the responsibility of the parents or the guardian who did not do their job by restraining them and controlling them, for example. And the same is for Hadith Rasulullah. Rufi al-Qalam, the pen has been lifted. There's nothing will be written against him as a sinner. One of these three who the pen has been lifted is the one who is small, صغير, until he reach maturity or majority. And they will stop in a few seconds because I think we have exceeded 1 hour. So, if you say this, if you write a law, for example, a law over one country, that the underage, we have to discuss what underage means, but let's assume we have a definition which we agree upon from some source. Underage is not responsible for his action, is not criminally responsible, for example. Then, or cannot be treated as a criminal at least, or they may be responsible for certain things, the financial things and so on. Yeah, okay. Then when you say, on whose ground did you do that? If you say that's on the ground that the Messenger of Allah said that the pen has been lifted, then you are a worshiper, you are a believer. You have referred to the Messenger of Allah, who is infallible, reporting from Allah. And if you refer it to, and you are a believer, and you are a mu'min, and if you refer so because that French law make this specification, which seems to be irrational, and you are a kafir. It's the same statement of the small children are not criminally responsible. It's the same. The same statement, but the one statement made by someone is Iman, because he referred it and deducted the statement from the Messenger of Allah, or from the Quran, or the Sunnah, or from someone who believes the Messenger of Allah. And the other one who referred to the French law is a kafir, because he's referring to, not to Allah, referring to someone else. So you could make the same statement, and one of them you are a worshiper and a believer, and the other one you are a mushrik and a kafir. The same statement, exactly the statement. The same one, for example, the prohibition of khamr in America. The prohibition was based on the decision of the Congress and to introduce an article in the Constitution at that time. Whoever referred to this and tried to enforce it and punish those who drink, for example, with authorization, referring to the decision of the American Congress and sovereignty of American people, is a mushrik and a kafir. But the same applies in the Islamic domain. There's a prohibition of khamr and selling khamr for Muslims and so on. So if you punish people with that, referring to Quran and Sunnah, the prohibition of the Quran, you are a believer. It's the same prohibition, essentially. Yeah, it may be fine details of legislative aspects, etc., etc. But that's, I'm not discussing the principle. So in fact, someone else says the khamr is prohibited, drinking is prohibited, and or selling khamr at least prohibited based on the sovereignty of the Congress, the American people, and others say based on the Quran and Sunnah. That one is a believer, this one is a kafir. So this is important. As I said, this is to establish that and clarify it and analyze the all the sentences in the Quran which mention ibadah, mention the way the Rabb, etc., and mention legislation and who was whoever rules with that, what Allah is, who doesn't rule is the kafir, etc. All of that needs a considerable expansion. While in the time of Islam, only the statement of the Prophet that was enough for Adi ibn Hatim because he immediately recognized his mistake. But the accumulation of theories, especially the mistake in the fuqaha calling the rituals like Hajj, like Zakah, and so on, ibadat, they are not ibadat. The acts of worship, the acts expressing worship, but they are not the worship. What the Quran means, I'abudu Rabbakum, not what the ma khalqtul jinna minsa illa liya'budu. That's not what the meaning of worship genuinely means. These are acts, better call them rituals, but unfortunately it's very difficult now to change the course of history and the fiqh books, although it can, fiqh books should be edited and improved in that direction. But this is should not be prevent us from recognizing the mistake of calling these ibadah or this ibadah. Say he's devoted to this man, is abid, he's devoted to ibadah because he prays a lot or performs hajj every year. No, that's not abid. That's not the ibadah which Allah wanted from us. These are injunctions, rituals. Some of them are obligatory, some of them are desirable, but that's all. No. Abid is the one who acknowledges the sovereignty of Allah unrestricted without any exception. Absolutely, yeah. That's the abid. And then this abid could be complying with the rituals as it should be. Then he's really actively expressing his worship, or could be negligent in that, and he's a fasiq and sinful and needs a certain treatment, which we'll discuss in due course as things come along. So this is ma'ana meaning ayyuhannas a'budu rabbakum. Does not mean that we perform salah, go to Hajj, to Mecca, do this, do that. No. Acknowledge your Lord as the sovereign, the one who defines good and evil, the one who, as he is the one who created you, the one before, he is the creator, he is the commander. He is the lawmaker. He is the one defining morality. Nobody else. He exclusively, he and he only. So that you may ward evil, the evil of a life which is no well-defined values and no direction, and the evil of the punishment in the fire of al qiyamah for someone who rejected faith after the message has reached him and he insisted on rejecting the message and not worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the message of all messengers, we'll come to the message of all the messengers, and that's also expanded in full detail in with the book of Tawheed. So I think it's enough for today. We stop here, inshallah, to continue next week. We'll see if there's any questions.
No questions have come through, Shaykh.
Inshallah. I said, these things are very obvious, I hope, especially for our Shabab, but maybe for the listener, it will be a little bit surprising that Abud Rabbakum does not mean performing salah, performing zakah. That's not Abud Rabbakum. That's it, not. These are divine injunctions based on that he is the sovereign who has the right, and you have acknowledged him that he has the right to do these injunctions. Whatever the injunctions may be, perform salah or do that, or don't eat from this tree, or don't go naked, or go naked. That's whatever he made an injunction, his injunction is the law. And what he defines as good, that's what is good. And what he creates the universe as good, like for example, good food for your physiology and your genetic makeup, that's good food. That's by his creative act. And good, what he has allowed to eat is permissible halal food by his legislative act. So he's the ultimate. He is the one who defines good and evil, both in the creative sense and the legislative sense. Okay, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, barakallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.